Welcome everyone, this is my launch review with testing and benchmarks for AMD's new Ryzen 9000 series processors, at least the two that launched today, the 6-core 9600X and the 8-core 9700X. This review is going to be a little bit weird though, a little bit different compared to my normal CPU launch reviews, and that's not AMD's fault, it's Intel's.
Excellent!
Today's video is brought to you by the Corsair K65 Plus Wireless RGB Keyboard, featuring silky smooth pre-lubricated Corsair MLX red mechanical switches, two layers of sound dampening for softened typing acoustics, AES encrypted connectivity via low latency 2.4 GHz wireless, Bluetooth or USB wired, a multi-purpose rotary dial with function key combos and shortcut commands, resilient PBT dye sublimated keycaps, and of course, per-key RGB lighting effects, which are endlessly customizable in Corsair's IQ software. For more on the Corsair K65 Plus, click the sponsor link in the video description. So if you're not familiar with the Intel situation affecting 13th and 14th gen Raptor Lake CPUs, there has been instability, intermittent crashing, even the possibility of degradation and CPUs failing over time, which Intel has addressed to some degree, but we are still waiting on their actual patch, their actual fix to get those CPUs supposedly functional in a way that won't cause them to fail down the line. Intel has promised that that patch will be coming out in mid-August, but it's not available yet. I am not currently comfortable recommending Intel 13th or 14th gen CPUs until that patch launches, and we cannot properly compare these new AMD CPUs to Intel until we can get that patch, so we're gonna need some more time. I do have some AMD versus AMD numbers to share with you. I'm gonna throw in some legacy values here and there so you can get a bit of an idea of how these stack up to the competition. Let's get started though by looking at a spec comparison for the four CPUs that I'm testing today. These new 9000 series processors are using the new Zen 5 microarchitecture, but you will notice some similarities between the specs otherwise, since we are still looking at 6-core 12-thread CPUs and 8-core 16-thread CPUs. But a big highlight I want to point out right from the start here is we have price reductions if you compare to the 7000 series when they launched. The 7700X was $400 MSRP at launch versus the 9700X, which is now $359 or $360. So that's a $40 drop right there. Meanwhile, the 9600X is going to be selling for $279, and that is a $20 drop versus the 7600X, which debuted for $290. So AMD is theoretically offering us better pricing, better efficiency thanks to the Zen 5 micro architecture and lower TDPs, and possibly even better performance. We'll find that out in just a moment, but keep in mind that in terms of CPU performance, we tend to split that into two categories. There is compute performance, which is usually measured using synthetic benchmarks or running workstation tasks, the stuff you do on a computer to actually get work done. And then there is gaming performance, which is how well a CPU can keep up with a graphics card. And in this case, we are testing the fastest graphics card currently on the market, the RTX 4090. The rest of the components for the test bed can be seen right here. It's not pretty, but it gets the job done. We're featuring an ASUS ROG Crosshair X670E Hero motherboard. The CPU cooler is a Corsair H150i Elite LCD 360mm AIO, which is overkill for the processors we're testing today, but I use that to maintain consistency with theoretical future tests I might be doing next week. And for those who don't want to spend $100 or $200 on an AIO, I did some air cooler testing too. We also have a 32GB G-Scale Trident Z5 Neo DDR5 6000 memory kit, a Kioxia XG6 1TB NVMe SSD, Corsair AX1600i 1600W power supply, and we're running the latest patched version of Windows 11. Let's start off with some power draw numbers, looking at the CPU package power, the peak measured during testing, as well as system power overall while running the Blender Monster test. Note that the 7600X, which is going to be the lowest performing CPU in my benchmarks, is also the highest power draw of the CPUs I'm testing. Now, the 7000 series was no slouch in terms of efficiency, so these results would look even better if I was comparing them directly to Intel. Let's get into some compute benchmarks though, starting with Cinebench R23. I am throwing some legacy numbers in here just so you have some points of comparison, but please note that the four CPUs I'm highlighting are the ones that were tested most recently. Versus the 7600X though, the 9600X is about 9.5% faster, and then versus the 7800X3D, which is going to run at a lower clock speed compared to the 7700X3D, for example, the 9700X is about 10.5% faster. Switching over to single thread scores, which is where the Zen 5 architecture is supposed to provide some nice gains, the 9600X was 11.5% faster than the 7600X, and the 9700X was 24.5% 4.5% faster than the 7800X3D. Here's Maxon's newer Cinebench test, Cinebench 2024. Here, the 9600X was about 8.1% faster than the 7600X, and the 9700X was 7.2% faster than the 7800X3D. Once again, switching to single-threaded scores, the 9700X here, with its slightly higher clock speed, was able to edge out the 9600X with 137. That puts the 9700X 22.3% ahead of the 7800X3D, while the 9600X was 13.4% ahead of the 7600X. Here's one more synthetic test, Passmark 11's CPU Mark Suite. And once again, the 9700X had some decent gains over the 7800X3D, coming in 5.2% faster in the multi-threaded test, while the 9600X was a lot closer to the 7600X here, only 3.3% faster. But again, switching over to single-thread results shows some more impressive gains. The 9700X was 24.7% faster than the 7800X3D here, while the 9600X was 10.7% faster than the 7600X. And now let's move to some software you can actually use. Here's Blender 4.2.0. We're running the Open Data 3.1 test, which runs Monster, Junk Shop, and Classroom, giving a total samples per minute score, so higher is better. A total score of 274.2 puts the 9700X 8.4% ahead of the 7800X3D, while the 9600X was 9.3% ahead of the 7600X. Here's Handbrake to show off video transcoding performance. We have an encoding speed as FPS and then time in seconds, where lower would be better. The 7800X3D actually edged out the 9700X in this test, coming in with the fastest time of 143 seconds, which was less than 1% ahead. For transcoding performance as well, the 9600X and 7600X were also quite close, only a 0.4% improvement for the 6-core 9000 series CPU. Here's Corona Temp, which gives a score in rays per second, where the 9700X hit a top score of 6,878,348. That put it 15.7% ahead of the 7800X3D, while the 9600X hit more than 5.5 million, putting it 14.7% ahead of the last gen 7600X. And my last compute focus benchmark is 7-zip, testing file compression and decompression. And here my results were a little bit anomalous. The 9000 series came in slower than the 7000 series that preceded it, although not by much. The 9700X was less than 1% behind the 7800X3D in compression, did manage to edge it out by 3.1% in decompression, while the 9600X was about 1.5% behind the 7600X in compression and a little over 5% behind in decompression. Rounding things up for my charted numbers, we have 3DMark TimeSpy Extreme showing the graphics and CPU score. Here we can see that the graphics score for the 4090 was within 1% for all four of the CPUs tested, which shows you that when you're not in a CPU limited situation, all four of these CPUs can keep up with the 4090, at least in this test. We'll see if that bears out in my game testing. And then the CPU focus test once again showed some nice gains for the 9000 series, with the 9700X coming in 11.1% ahead of the 7800X3D, and the 9600X coming in 4.1% ahead of the 7600X. And now for some gaming benchmarks, but I decided to do these a little bit differently with side-by-side performance comparisons, because since these CPUs cost about $280 and $360 MSRP, and the 7800X3D, the fastest CPU for gaming currently, can go for around $350 to $375 on sale, the obvious question for a lot of gamers who are about to buy a new system would be, should I get the new 9000 series, or should I just go with the 7800X3D, or wait for the 9000X3D CPUs to launch, which should theoretically be coming out later this year, per rumors. So let's start off with Cyberpunk 2077 running at 1920 by 1080 with the ray traced ultra preset, DLSS balanced enabled, and ray reconstruction and frame generation turned off. I tested at 1080 and 4K. At 1080 we are more CPU limited, and at 4K it's a bit more of a reasonable resolution for the RTX 4090. Here at 1080 though, the 9600X was about 115 to 120 FPS on average while we're inside the bar. That cranks up a little bit to about 125 to 140 peak versus the 9700X, which is a little bit faster, 115 to 125 inside, and getting up to 125 to 140 frames per second peak. The 7800X3D maintains a consistent and substantial lead though, at 140 to 150 FPS, peaking at 165 to 175. Switching over to 4K or 3840 by 2160, the 9600X struggles a little bit more, hitting 80 to 85 FPS on interior and 90 to 100 peak. The 9700X is just about the same, maybe a few FPS faster, 80 to 90 FPS on the interior and peaking at 90 to 100, just behind the 7800X 3D. Note that the gap is much closer here versus 1080, with the 7800X 3D getting to 80 to 90 FPS, maybe 95, then peaking around 100 or just over. Our next game is Starfield. Here at 1080, we're running with the Ultra preset. Dynamic resolution is turned off. The 9600X managed 100 to 115 FPS. Lows dipped down to 85 to 100. The 9700X was once again just a little bit faster, 105 to 120 FPS on average, with lows dipping to the 90 to 100 range. And once again, the 7800X 3D was able to eke quite a few more frames out of the RTX 4090, 130 to 155 FPS, with lows staying well above 100 in the 115 to 125 FPS range. Switching over to Starfield at 4K, the FPS dips a bit, but not a whole lot. We're at 90 to 105 for the 9600X, about 95 to 115 for the 9700X. Lows are around 80 to 90 range for the 9600X and 90 to 100 for the 9700X. Note, the GPU usage here is maxed out at 98 to 99% while running at 4K, which is why there's not as much of a gap with the 7800X 3D, around 100 to 120. Next up, we have F123 at 1920 by 1080. We're running the ultra high preset with DLSS quality turned on and reflex turned off. Here, the 9600X was in the 180 to 205 frames per second range. Lows occasionally dipped down to 165 to 180. The 9700X managed to stay a few more steps ahead of the 9600X versus other titles. It got up to 200 to 230 frames per second with lows down in the 175 to 185 range, while the 7800X 3D was able to maintain a lead over both 9000 series CPUs once again. Switching to 4K once again for F123, the 9600X and 9700X are pretty much neck and neck here, getting about 140 to 155 frames per second on average, lows occasionally dipping to 130 to 140 range here. We're pretty much entirely GPU dependent at this resolution, although the 7800X 3D does still maintain a narrow lead. Finally, we have Microsoft Flight Simulator, because there's always a few people who are like, hey Paul, thanks for testing Flight Simulator. At 1080, we are running DirectX 12, the Ultra graphics preset, reflex, and frame generation are turned off. The 9600X is around 70 to 75 frames per second, lows in the 50 to 70 range, and that's specifically while landing when the frame rate dips. The 9700X was just barely faster, maybe like one frame faster, 71 to 76 FPS with lows in the 50 to 70 range. Although I will say, the 9700X here was where I got my best, most softest landing, and I actually got an A rating, which is, I've never gotten an A rating before, that was nice. But I'm getting distracted. The 7800X 3D did maintain a lead, hitting 85 to 90 frames per second, so it is still going to be the processor of choice for flight simulator enthusiasts. Meanwhile, over at 4K, we lose a few frames, but not a lot. The 9600X was in the 69 to 76 FPS range, with lows down around 45 to 65. The 9700X was actually a frame or two slower at 4K, about 68 to 74 FPS, with lows in the 45 to 65 range, and the 7800X 3D once again maintained a lead, 78 to 85 FPS, lows around 55 to 75, again with that landing part. So I think it is safe to say with all of these results that the 7800X 3D is still quite clearly, at least with my tests, the better choice for gaming, at least until the 9000 series comes out with their X3D 3D V-Cache enabled versions. Now, I wanted to try to add a bit more practical value to my testing, and I know testing with the 360mm all-in-one liquid cooler isn't the best choice for something like this, because a lot of people are gonna say, well, these X series processors have thin boxes because they don't come with cooling solutions. Can I get by with something that's not gonna be $100 plus? It just so happens that I have a Thermalright Phantom Spirit Evo air cooler here on hand, so I decided to swap that in and run a stress test to compare the all-in-one to the air cooling. The Phantom Spirit Evo typically costs around $35 to $40. Installation wasn't too difficult either, and I ran a 10-minute IDA 64 stress test and then took the temperature readings afterwards. So here's my results for the 9700X. The 360 AIO did perform well. We hit 75.6C peak according to hardware info. It was averaging around 70 to 73 degrees Celsius. The hottest temperature measured was 85.8 on CCD1. These temperatures are noticeably down from the Ryzen 7000 series processors, which regularly get up to 90C and above. And this was a synthetic stress test, which is gonna put a lot more of a load on the CPU than you would ever do with gaming or even workstation applications. So it is nice that the Thermalright Phantom Spirit Evo was only about 3 degrees warmer, 78.6 degrees Celsius peak, averaging around 74 to 75 degrees C while the test was still running, and only 1 degree hotter, 86.8 C on CCD1. So for the 8-core, yes, the sub $40 cooler can keep up just fine. Yes, it's a few degrees warmer, but it's also a lot less money. Meanwhile, the 9600X should need even less cooling. It hits 76.1 peak temperature, 73 to 74 degrees average, 83.4 C was the peak temp on CCD1, whereas the Thermalright Phantom Spirit Evo was only about 1 degree warmer, 77.2 degrees peak, 74 to 75 degrees on average, and 82.9 C peak on CCD1. So hopefully that gives you guys a nice look at some of the various performance aspects of the 9600X and 9700X. Now is where I would typically do my conclusion, but I feel like my conclusion needs a little bit more time to percolate. So maybe give me, I don't know, a week or so before I come back to give you guys a broader overview of the entire stack of CPUs that AMD just launched, and hopefully maybe even some better comparisons to Intel, if Intel actually gets off their butts and posts that patch so we can test properly. It is quite clear to me that the new 9000 series processors have an edge, a leg up on the 7000 series processors in terms of efficiency, and you can't complain about the prices being better than last gen either. So clearly these would be the best choice if you're not concerned about gaming. If you are concerned about gaming, however, AMD's their own worst enemy, because the clear choice is going to be the 7800X 3D, especially if you're pairing it with a higher end GPU like an RTX 4090 or even like 4080 Super, 4070 Ti, 7900 XT or XTX. You're going to get better frame rates out of your GPU in CPU limited situations with that 7800X 3D, or by holding off 1, 2, 3 months, we're not really sure, until the presumably, hopefully, 9800X 3D launches, which should have all of the performance improvements of these CPUs while also having that 3D V-cache, which should provide it at least equivalent, if not better, gaming performance at the same time. But that's all the time I have for this video, you guys. If you enjoyed it, hit the thumbs up button. I'll post links to the processors and stuff like that in the description down below. And also, when it comes to reviews, you shouldn't just get one person's or one outlet's opinion. So I'm gonna collect a few other reviews that come up today, and I'll post those down in the video's description as well if you'd like some further reading or some other outlets who have tested in different ways than I did today. Closing reminder to check out my store at paulshardware.net if you'd like to help support my channel by getting yourself some awesome merch. Thank you once again for watching, and we'll see you all in the next video.